I'm Carla Grant and welcome to this special arts edition of Living Black, celebrating 10 years on Australian television. Coming up on the program, we look back at the legacy of the Black Theatre.
They really wanted to write about the state of the Aboriginal man and woman living in Australia during that period.
Two young singers from the Torres Strait Islands keeping their culture alive.
If I speak in language, I can feel there's a strength there. There's an inner strength there.
And an emerging hip-hop artist reveals how music saved him from drugs and alcohol.
You just gotta, you know, stick it out and stick to your gums.
Born out of the fight for equal rights in the 1970s, the Black Theatre Company fused political activism with performing arts. The result was a cultural revolution. Alan Clark reports on the legacy of Black Theatre.
You young children around there, you mothers and fathers, do you want your kids to grow up in a fascist country?
It was a time of change, a unified Aboriginal voice demanding equal rights, culminating in waves of protests. But violent clashes with police could not stop the rising tide of political upheaval in 1970s Australia. Amidst this human rights movement was a beating artistic heart. Out of the darkness, a glimpse into Sydney's Redfern in the early 70s. Now a suburb mired in controversy, was once a hotbed of Aboriginal political activism and performance. Much of it centred around the now-defunct National Black Theatre Company.
There was a renaissance that occurred in this country, and it was revisiting Aboriginal arts and culture. But specifically, there was a real grasp of the political movement. Would this show have got up if they weren't commissioned by Havi?
Earlier this year, a comprehensive retrospect shone a spotlight on this period of innovative forward thinkers.
Look, it was an incredible time and it was a difficult time. It was still a time when Australia had the White Australia policy. So you're looking at a group of the new generation of young men and women who were ready to be vocal about the inequalities in this country.
Is it a bat? Is it a crow? Is it the flying doctor? No, it's Super Bong.
The Black Theatre Company often produced provocative works. Infamous black superhero Super Bong,
faster than a killer boomerang,
and the play Here Comes the Nigger to publicise human rights abuses.
And this is where it all began. In this house in the 70s, a group of political activists and artists got together. It would spawn a generation of new Indigenous theatre and introduce political activism into the world of arts.
Now an empty terrace, it was once home to some of the nation's most prolific Aboriginal personalities. Some of them include actor and Order of Australia Medal recipient Justine Saunders, actor Bob Mazza, and Australia's first published Aboriginal playwright Kevin Gilbert. The troupe even led a theatrical protest in Canberra outside Parliament House, ending in dozens of arrests.
I think it's a great reflection that we look at what those people gave, particularly when you think many of these men and women were incarcerated. They'd written their work in terrible conditions, but they really wanted to write about the state of the Aboriginal man and woman living in Australia during that period.
Today, many are deceased, but their legacy and spirit lives on stages across the country.
And if you'd like to comment on that story, just head to our Facebook page. Still to come on Living Black, we go inside the big tent and meet the spectacular Black Rabats. Welcome back to this special arts edition of Living Black. From the tightrope to the trapeze, it seems everybody loves a visit to the circus. Josh Ridgway went inside the big tent to discover an Indigenous troupe of performers called Black Rabats.
Roll up, roll up. The circus is in town. From daredevil feats to magic and outrageous laughs, Circus Oz has been entertaining audiences for decades. Now they're after a new act and they're looking towards Indigenous talent.
What's really exciting is the opportunity to kind of introduce a new medium for our mob to create and express and tell our stories through circus.
They've created Blackrobatics, a workshop skilling up Indigenous hopefuls to perform under the Big Top.
It's quite therapeutic. I can get into my mind and concentrate on just one thing, staying on the wire.
Guy Simons is trying out for the tightrope, no easy feat. He says acts like the trapeze, tumbling and backflips are also major draw cards.
It's a physical thing within us to excel at sport, dance and circus. We're just naturally physical. And I think circus is a really good outlet because we're always, I don't know, feeling with something, throwing a ball or doing backflips into the water and stuff like that.
A tradition of Indigenous talent that can be traced back to the tightrope in the 1930s and the relatively unknown story of Aboriginal performer Con Colino. Known as the Wizard of the Wire, Colino was celebrated for his highly skilled forward somersault troubadour act. Though Colino was a hit on the international circuit, the origins of Aboriginal involvement in the circus has a darker history.
There's a story of Tambo, an old man Tambo and his family. They were deceived into getting on board a boat, and then they were toured across the Americas and they were in the sideshows and bannered as professional savages.
In 1994, the family and descendants of the North Queensland man found closure when his remains were returned home from the US. But the story of ancestral loss is one many modern day performers are still coming to terms with.
I was like all against the circus. Not against it, but a bit iffy about coming down here because my great-great-grandfather was shown in a cage in the circus back in, you know, the old days when he was stolen and stuff. So it's nice coming here now in this time and like just having the freedom to do what you feel and have a laugh and, you know.
We can build this future together, from the ground up.
Performers Genoa Gila and Dale Woodbridge have graduated from the Blackrobatics workshop and are star performers in the latest show at Cirque Oz. They're using dance, song and story to tie in cultural and political messages on inclusion and want more Indigenous performers to get involved.
Some black fellas are really smart that they can flip like that, you know, or they can make people laugh like that. It's just an opportunity to get paid to do something you're really deadly at.
I play a character named Dez. he's a bit of a bogan. I wear a mullet and kind of he's the roadie, but he's a jack of all trades, but he wants to be a model.
For Dale Woodbridge, being part of the circus is all about giving back to community through laughter.
I've always believed that if I can make somebody smile once a day, then I've lived a full life, and doing the circus, I'm getting a whole crowd full.
From the Big Top to the Big Apple, the pair are headed for New York with the circus.
In order to change the world, you need to change people's hearts first, and it is through the arts. That's the best way to reach people's hearts, through, you know, songs that have been written, listening to, you know, music, dance and theatre and circus as well.
A top class act.
In the Torres Strait, music plays an important part of life. Alan Clark caught up with two young singers keeping their culture alive.
Yesterday is truly gone. There's a pagan moon rising on the coral sea.
The sound of an island melody.
Red as the embers of
drifting across an ancient and remote landscape.
While the old man sits alone, while his village people sleep.
As far as rehearsal spaces go, this has got to be one of the best in the world.
Yesterday,
on the edges of Mer Island, commonly known as Murray Island in the Torres Strait, local musician Joey Tapau sings a song inspired by ancestors who lived here.
You're connected to the land as well, and you're writing all these songs and singing all these songs that your forefathers have made. and it's been handed down, and your uncles and your aunties made all these songs, and they know that you're the singer in the family, and they come up and say, oh, you know, you should sing this song, this is how it goes. And now, in these days, like, we contemporize our traditional music.
Born in the Straits and raised in Townsville, Joey moved back to Murray Island this year. His songs are a vocal affirmation of identity and used as a way of reconnecting with his islander heritage. Using an ancient chorus traditionally used as a chant in Torres Strait Islander dance, Joey's inspiring others, like his nephew, to use music as a way of keeping customs alive.
For me, when I wake up every day, I just sing, and that's what I love doing.
Music and the Torres Strait Islands are inextricably linked. Here, music is everything. Traditionally, songs held the key to traditional language, Bible verses, and were ancient libraries, detailing sacred sites and ceremony. Today, the legacy continues. Each house has at least one singer. One of the most famous, Christine Arnoux. Raised in Cairns, but inspired by her Torres Strait Islander heritage. On Purima Island, a breathtakingly beautiful tropical paradise, Freddie David has dreams to become just as successful.
If I speak in language, I can feel there's a strength there. There's an inner strength there.
Recently signed to a record deal, Freddie is reinvigorating the local language, one that is being eroded by Creole. Despite the potential for fame, Freddie remains determined to ensure younger generations join his musical cultural crusade.
There is a battle of, you know, getting things right in our community, but if there is a will, there is a way. So I think what we must do now is never give up, but keep the river flow.
Two different men with two very distinct styles, bound by the love for their island homes.
If you'd like to see that story again, just go to our website. Coming up on Living Black, an emerging hip-hop artist reveals the challenges he faced while releasing his latest album. You're watching Living Black celebrating 10 years on air. This year's prestigious Archibald Prize featured the likes of Anthony Mundine and Elder Wilfred Hicks. But whilst Indigenous subjects have been popular over the years, an Indigenous artist is yet to win the coveted award. Laura Murphy Oates reports.
The most coveted art prize in Australia. The Archibald Prize is a vivid display of the best Australian artists have to offer. This year's winner was awarded the Archibald Prize for the second time in only 5 years. Part of her inspiration, Indigenous art.
Oh, so inspired, and clearly, and at the risk of stating the obvious, some of Australia's best painters are Indigenous artists. I mean, even though I just think it's better that we don't delineate in that way, we're all kind of making paintings as peers, but Hugo also has a strong connection to the Australian landscape. That was definitely something that I was trying to evoke in this painting.
And she wasn't the only prize winner to draw their inspiration from Indigenous art. The Wynn Prize, awarded for best landscape and sculpture, went to Imans Tillers. He says his winning painting was inspired by one of the most prominent Indigenous artists of all time.
It's a homage to Albert Namatjira and to his importance and legacy, but it's also a kind of lamentation about what he encountered, you know, all the sort of contradictions and the terrible things that kind of happened to him despite being so celebrated.
a painter from the Papunya Tula group, Yakulchi Napangadi, was highly commended in the Wynn Prize, an area Indigenous artists are renowned for. In the Archibald, Indigenous subjects remain popular, with some iconic figures featuring in the winning portraits over the last few years. This year's display of finalists had its fair share of Indigenous stars.
What got me really interested in Anthony Mundine is during his lead up to the 2006 fight with Danny Green, and he came over to promote the fight in West Australia, where I'm from, and like he'd been portrayed in the media as this bad guy who talked too much, but when I met him in like real life, or when other people met him, he was really down to earth and really generous with his time. He was a really friendly guy and spoke to the Indigenous community and also to young boxers, and I thought that was really inspiring.
Whilst Indigenous subjects have been popular at the Archibald Prize, Indigenous artists have been highly underrepresented. No Indigenous artist has ever been awarded this prestigious prize. The former director of the Art Gallery of New South Wales says a lack of Indigenous winners may have something to do with the form of portraiture.
Really, if you think about the Aboriginal instinct and vision in art and the visual arts, it's really been dominated by the landscape and the spirit of the landscape and the stories of the landscape. So really, you know, in a way, portraiture has always been the second cousin, so to speak, in Australian art.
Julie Dowling is the sole Indigenous finalist in this year's Archibald. Julie prefers portraits to landscape, as she says painting figures allows her to record their humanity and explore issues like Aboriginal identity, colonial histories, and racism. Her portrait of Indigenous elder Wilfred Hicks was in the top five finalists in this year's Archibald.
You've got Julie Dowling here with Wilfred Hicks, which is a terrific painting and a really great, great, solid, real portrait painting.
An established national and international artist, Julie is concerned about the lack of Indigenous representation in the prize.
Well, Indigenous art makes 67% of the field, so that's more than half. I think it'd be interesting to see that sort of representation at a national level. They can actually understand that, you know, a majority of mob actually do paint. And there are a fair few portrait painters, whether they enter into portrait prizes like the Arts Award or not, they are still producing portraits.
During his time as an Archibald trustee, Amance was instrumental in championing the cause of Indigenous art. He made the controversial decision to include this painting by Weaver Jack in amongst the 2006 finalists.
She entered this work, which was completely the same as paintings of country, but she entered it as a self-portrait, and I made sure that it got hung because it would extend the notion of portraiture to, you know, Aboriginal people, you know, because country is quite closely tied to their identity. So that was a bit of a breakthrough.
Julie Dowling may be breaking new ground, with her and other contemporary Indigenous artists carving out a new place in the Australian art world.
I think things are happening, and, you know, some of the more contemporary Aboriginal artists, Richard Bell uses portraits a bit, and, of course, Ricky Maynard, as a photographer, has done a great, great series of portraits as well. So it's not there, but it's not yet strongly there.
Whilst Indigenous artists continue to enjoy success with paintings of country, there seems to be a growing movement towards portraiture. And who knows, next year it could be an Indigenous artist that claims Australia's most prestigious art prize.
Earlier this year, we introduced you to emerging hip-hop artist Bright as he released his self-titled album, Bright Side of Life. While making his mark on the music scene, the 28-year-old revealed the challenges he's had to face in an effort to succeed in the industry. Dale Lawton has more. Get back on the
bright side of life. Bright Side of Life from the City of Lights. This Perth-based rap artist has seen brighter days since he emerged on the hip-hop scene.
Since I was about 8 years old, I guess, I've always listened to hip-hop. My cousins got me into it. My foster cousins got me into Tupac and, you know, like Big E, and started to listen to like people, like Tribe Called Quest. So I started writing in year eight. Yeah, So probably about 13, 14, started writing. And all the kids who
walk for miles just to... But life for this artist hasn't always glistened. Fostered out at just 3 months old, Bright reflects on not only how lucky he felt with his adoptive parents, but also how hard it was living with the truth about his biological family.
My biological mum, she has paranoid schizophrenia and also cerebral palsy. So I guess growing up was kind of, you know, meeting new friends and things like that and introducing, why is your mum and dad white? What's wrong with your mum? That sort of stuff. So growing up was an interesting experience. And all you want to do is crawl into the
wall space. But through this form of artistry, Bright was able to escape from imposing demons like drugs and alcohol.
Yeah, I guess you could call it therapy. Therapy for the mind and for the soul. You know, just being an MC, I think, and just writing, spending time and getting to know, I guess, myself, getting to know my inner workings, like, as I write.
Now, with the backing of MGM Distribution, DJ Monkey Muck from Courier Radio, a long-time advocate for Bright's music, believes he has a promising future.
And a lot of our Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander hip-hop artists, they aren't in the shops, you know what I mean? So it's like, it's a good thing that he's got distribution with MGM, because that gets him in record shops, which is a plus, it's a bonus, because it means that he's moving forward. The good thing about Bright is he's a funny guy. You know what I mean? That's the thing. He's got a sense of humour and he's amusing. So, and that's something that the mainstream hip-hop can get into.
Quirky and quick-witted, this inspiring Bright spark knew that life of destitution and dejection wasn't for him. And it was those closest to him that made him take a stand in his career.
That's where I draw most of my inspiration, is from those around me, just like mates and family. I think that's what drives my passion as well, and myself. I see myself as an Aussie hip-hop artist, Australian hip-hop artist, Indigenous hip-hop artist. I play closely to that role. I keep my culture. Since I was 15, I wanted to spit. Make tracks, sick raps, full of knowledge and shit. And the fate had it a fact, I was solid with this. But I was young and unproven, we're dropping a script. So I made friends with the soul who could flow. Most remain my mates, now some of them foes.
Although Bright admits that the path behind him may have been tough, it's what lies ahead that remains the real challenge.
The hardest thing for me has been like staying alive and like being able to feed, put food in the fridge and, you know, pay the rent and things like that. You know, being an artist and coming up, you know, you don't get paid a lot, so you have to take on extra jobs, and it's not necessarily music, just to pay the bills, I guess. It's all good in the end though. Like, you just gotta, you know, stick it out and stick to your guns.
And as the name suggests from his self-titled second album, this MC always looks on the bright side of life. Get back on the bright
side of life. Well, that's all we have time for in today's program. I hope you've enjoyed this special arts edition of Living Black. If you'd like to see any of our stories from today or previous episodes again, just visit our website at sbs.com.au/livingblack. You can also follow us on Facebook, YouTube and Twitter. On behalf of the team, thanks for joining us. I'm Carla Grant. See you next time.